density operator explicitly in terms of the expectation value of the algebra, and since it's a compact closed algebra, it's, you even don't need a canonical form. You can do it in a linear way like people do in NMR.
So basically the cycle is just spending some energy cost to create the coherence and then erase it.
Yeah. So you could do shortcuts to algebraicity in the same way, but there's no transition. It's always oscillatory, unlike the harmonic oscillator case when you go from oscillatory to here. It's always oscillatory. Okay. So are there any questions up to here? So now, yeah?
Can you come back to this side? My question is about the conical invariance.
Where?
The conical invariance. What do you mean by the conical invariance?
Canonical invariance.
Yes. And why do you need conical invariance in this context?
Okay, why do I want it? It's a good question because maybe. In the one hand, you can say, I solved Heisenberg equations of motion, and I can get certain things of the engine out of that, and I don't have to. So if my Heisenberg equations of motion are closed, you can say I can learn about a lot about my engine. But we're interested in thermodynamics, so we want to learn, in a way, an additional layer. So if I just know the expectation values, let's say H, L and C, this is what I get from Heisenberg equations of motion. But now I want to know about the entropy. What's the entropy of my system? So three variables are not enough to define the entropy, because you can say harmonic oscillator has infinitely many energy levels, and you can write the matrix, the generalized, this general matrix of the density operator is infinite dimensional. So I have entries everywhere. So this if I would give you infinite many numbers, I describe completely the state of the system. But this is overkill. You can't work with that. In principle, if you give me this, I can calculate the entropy, the von Neumann entropy. With a trace. So if you give me this, you can say diagonalize this and calculate this and tell you this is the von Neumann entropy of my state, or I can give you the energy entropy. So this is a thermodynamical quantity that I want to use and to learn about my system. So this is there's too many numbers here. I can't do that. So I want to reduce my description. So you could say that's a reduced description or much more economical description of the engine. On the other hand, I know I solved all with these three variables, I solved the dynamics. So the question is, can I only use this to get everything else? So this is possible if I can write my density operator as functions of H, L, and C. If I can do that, then I can calculate everything out of it. So to do this, I have to put an additional assumption. This additional assumption that the form of my density operator is canonical. For harmonic oscillators, it's a generalized Gaussian. So it also you can reach that the same conclusion from there. And so if I assume that, and in a way I'll show you that even if it doesn't start like that, it will be okay. If I assume that my density operator has a canonical form, then I know how to calculate it. I can define everything with respect to these three numbers. And this in a way is what I showed you here, it looks complex, but so what? Here. I have three expectation values, and I give you the canonical form. So here I get beta, and here I get gamma. So in a way I solve it. But so now you can say, if I did that and I assume canonical form, I know how to do it, and then I can calculate the entropy, which is in the next slide. But then you could ask, okay, is it true that any engine like that will be in a canonical form all the time? Let's say I started from a different state, not canonical. Will it become canonical? So this is an interesting point, which is related. You can say this is a question between steady state and equilibrium. In equilibrium, you know that if I started from anywhere, I'll reach to a Gibbs state in equilibrium. All the other moments, you could say that I start, it doesn't matter how I started, I'll reach equilibrium. Here we're talking about steady state. So we can start from anywhere. Initially, a few cycles will come until all the higher moments will decay. With higher moments, I mean moments which are not HLC, which are needed more variables to describe your initial state. Now you can show that higher moments will decay faster. So eventually, no matter where you start, the limit cycle, which is what interests us, will be defined completely by these three variables. So our engine, will, because we're looking at the limit cycle, these variables are sufficient to describe the engine operation. Now you would say that the approach to this limit cycle doesn't have to work like that. I need maybe more variables. But once I'm in the steady state, I'm in a canonical form throughout. So you can say in this case, the generalized canonical form is a generalization of steady state to a canonical form that's equilibrium. This is, I hope I answered your question some.
Yeah.
But think about it. Okay. Well, how much time do I have?
You can go
10 minutes?
No, 10, 15 minutes,
oh, good.
Even 20 minutes.
Good. I want to address two things important. One thing that I want to go in a way back to is this limit cycle. We have our map, we call it U cycle. This is our map, which takes, as we said, that brings us from here to here. This was our definition of the limit cycle, and we say this is steady state. Now we want to think about this in a thermodynamical way. And in a way, this also answers your question indirectly. The question is, I start from some state, doesn't matter what. Do I monotonically get closer to the limit cycle? What does it mean to become monotonic? Or can I prove that eventually I'll reach this state? So there are many ways to prove that. I'll show you a certain way to show that. And it depends on the properties of this propagator, the cycle propagator. So what can we say about this propagator here? Mathematically, we can say it's completely positive. This is Cp. Why can we say it's completely positive? Because we built it from completely positive maps. We have a unitary map, a dissipative map, a unitary map, a dissipative map. So if each component is completely positive, everything is completely positive. So now we know that this is a completely positive map. So then, this is a work by Lindblad, that you could ask about what does a completely positive map do to the distance between two operators. So if I have rho A and rho B, and then I have my map, let's call it U cycle, or just U. So I have B prime, and I have A prime, which is the same map. So here's our two original states. Then we take our map, apply it to B, apply it to A, and we get two new, I'll put the primes here, two new states. So what do you expect? So now let's think about it in general, then we'll use a definition. Does the distance become closer, farther? What happens to the some kind of notion of a metric, of distance between these two states? If these two states are identical, you can say their scalar product should be 1, for example. So there are many ways to define distance. We can use trace distance, you can use other types. I'll use a certain definition from Lindblad. But what do we expect? If it's unitary, we know it's just a rotation in some general space. A rotation doesn't change distances. So if our map would be unitary, we don't change distance. It's a kind of, you can say, general Hilbert space. We have a vector here and a vector here, and we do something like that. But this is, we have a dissipative component. Let's think about it. If they both reach equilibrium, eventually the distance will be 0. So what we expect is that the dissipative dynamics does contraction. It reduces the distance. So Lindblad used what we call conditional entropy. Which is trace O A. I think I get that right. Yeah. Or sometimes, this is sometimes confused, relative entropy, conditional entropy. This is it's not a metric, it's not really a measure of a distance. This is called
divergence.
So it's a good measure of distance. And we can make it symmetric, but it doesn't matter for the argument. So this is the distance between A and B. And now I want to apply my map. So I can say your S. So I'll apply my map here, and I'll apply my map here. So this distance becomes always smaller or equal to what we had before. So our map contracts. So now what we can do, let's look, let's say that rho B, I did it the opposite, is our steady state. Means that U times rho B with all these steady state. So this is already our target. So what I can write, I need space here. What I can write is the following, that S here. S U O A times U O B. I can write this as equal first. So S U O A. And here I can write O B because this is steady state. Because this didn't change. And this is smaller than what we had before, OA times OB. But I can continue this. So here I did one cycle, but I can do S U squared, or I'll write it U times U. Or A, and again this would stay or B because it's steady state, and I can go n times or infinite amount of times, okay, so what do I get? I get a series of terms that each term is smaller than the other. So this is a Cauchy series. So it has to converge. Now, this conditional entropy is bounded by zero. So it can converge to zero, which means that rho A, rho B will be the same. And, or it will converge to something, but okay, this becomes closer to the question about is there fuller ergodicity in this map if everything is connected to everything. So if there's only one invariant of my map, there's only one invariant, it will reach zero. It means that any initial state will reach to the limit cycle to the canonical invariant. So if we get degeneracy, then we could jump between two states, which is an interesting thing. We get an unstable engine. So there is a possibility here to get instability if we have two invariants of my map. But the map that I have has only one invariant. So this argument by Lindblad is kind of a second law type of argument that these types of maps lead you to, in this case, of our engine to steady state, and if it's just thermalization, it tells us that we'll thermalize in a monotonic way. So we know our car will start it, will thermalize. When thermalized, will reach its steady state in a monotonic fashion. Okay, so this is really to show why we want to calculate entropies to get this. These arguments can be used in different ways, but they are the same arguments that sometimes people call Sponz inequality, which are used for master equations. They're based on the same ideas. This paper is Lindblad 1974. Before the result that I told you about the Lindblad equation. So, he was just considering properties of CP maps. Okay. Now, finally, before lunch, I want to illustrate a certain idea, which will connect me to what I'm going to talk about tomorrow. So, we have an engine. And we can play with it, go to the engineers and say, okay, we can operate it faster. But if we operate it faster, for each segment we get less. So you can say per cycle we'll get less work. But since a cycle will take less time, maybe we'll get more power. So in a way, the question is, okay, what happens to the limit when I take my cycle time or my segments to zero? So you can say there's a general idea here that my U was UH, or I started here, UH, UH to C, UC, UC to H. So I can write it like that. Now I want to do each one of them small action, very little, so I can do things faster. So I want to think, okay, if I do things each segment here very little, then what does this become? This becomes a continuous engine. So this allows me, if I want to think about it, if I reduce the amount of action that I do in this each propagator, I reach to the limit of a continuous engine. So how can we do that? If we can say, as we said, that each U like that is, we can write it at e to the power of some L times some time that I allocate to that. So this L can be either unitary or the dissipative part or whatever. Now the whole idea, the action is basically the norm of these two together. How much time and how much I operate. So it's an operator norm, which is dependent on how big is L, how much I'm going to move things around. In a way, you can think about this like an angle in phase space, in a generalized Hilbert space. How much, if this angle is small, this is a limit of small action. If I go along my Bloch sphere like that, that's large action. So I'm going to define my engine from small segments. I'm going to do a very small trajectory in my Bloch sphere, or in my generalized like that. So if my action is small, I can write this tau CH L, let's say CH, e to the power of L, C tau C, e to the power of L, HC, tau AC, and e to the power of LH, tau H. It's just writing it in a different way. Okay, but now, as we said, these operators do not commute with one each other. So we have a product of four operators. But if these things are very small, each one of them has small action, we can write this approximately up to corrections, which are second order in commutators, as e to the power of L, let's say we said that CH, and let's say I use the same time, LC, plus L HC plus L H times some time. So the approximation that I'm using here, I'm changing a product form into a sum. This is correct up to commutators of these two to second order. So if the action is small, this is a good approximation. But if you look at this, what is this? This is some Liouville operator of a continuous engine. Because here I can take the order as ever I want. So this is my continuous engine. You can see the hot and the cold parts are connected simultaneously. And the work parts are connected simultaneously. Everything is connected with everything. So, in the limit of small action, I brought my engine to become a continuous engine. You can say there is no difference between a continuous engine and a discrete engine. So, this is a mathematical exercise, which is, you can say this limit is correct. But where's the physics? The physics is hiding in these commutators. As we said before, these things can't commute, which also means that these pieces here can't commute here, inside this term here, because this is the same. But then, so the question is, can we, where is the power coming from this continuous engine? So we know we need these operators not to commute. So the question is, where is it required? So as we said in the auto engine, in the thermal engine, we don't need quantum mechanics for them not to commute. We just have the thermalization shouldn't commute with the adiabatic part. But here, once we brought it here, this is not enough. We have to generate coherence. So you can say this doesn't look just a mathematical exercise, but it means that every continuous engine, for its operation, you need to generate coherence. And it also means if you'll add a dephasing term, you'll kill the engine. For just to illustrate that, we can do this explicitly for the harmonic oscillator. The harmonic oscillator, as we said, we have the propagator. We can write the propagator for the sudden case and do small action. I have it here. And it doesn't, it's still abstract, but it works in the same way. I'll just so, for the harmonic oscillator, if we take these pieces, this piece is already okay, because we know how to write it. But in the sudden limit of, let's say, for example, hc, we can write it this is uncoupled. In a way, this is almost trivial to show that in the sudden limit, we're changing instantaneously, we're opening our trap. So we're changing omega. So there's no, C is not generated, the third operator is not generated, only H and L are generated, and C, or this alpha, is the square of the compression ratio. So this is an exact expression for the propagator of the sudden limit. We can stick it here. Thermalization, we can stick here, which means that we can completely solve the sudden limit and the limit of the harmonic oscillator, and which also means that we can reach to this continuous limit. And if we kill the coherence, in this case, if we kill L, nothing will happen. There will be no power generated out. Okay, so the last thing I did is I connected to what we'll talk about tomorrow, about continuous engines. So I think I'll answer questions, but I think it's good time for lunch.